Hello, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Kasumi. Is it working? My name is Kasumi Yasukawa, working for, I'm a principal research manager in National Institute of Advanced Industrial Science and Technology, and I'm originally geothermal reservoir engineer. And I'm very glad to welcome you all in this room. And I would like to make a short starting speech for our session. So I will show you the slide. Let me begin by showing you a remarkable expansion of geothermal power in the world. Geothermal power will be increased more in the future, as it is expected as one of the most promising renewable energy sources. Geothermal heat, direct use of geothermal heat, is also increasingly used around the world. Direct use of geothermal heat is a traditional way of using geothermal energy, but yet plays an important role in primary energy supply. Innovation and future development of geothermal energy will have a great impact in fueling transit to a low carbon society. Technological development and institutional change will be expected to facilitate such innovation. Most notably, enhanced geothermal system, EGS, in other words, engineered geothermal system, EGS, is a most much expected technology that enables geothermal power development in the area where it used to be impossible to do so. We have today some experts to talk about this EGS system, the newest technology. There are also sub-technologies or new systems that enable sustainable operation of geothermal electricity generation or heat utilization. We have professionals from Italy and Iceland to talk about it. Let me now give a brief run through of today's proceedings. After my opening address, we will hear from four leading experts on the latest trend in the world. The first speaker, Dr. Ruggero Bertani from ENEL Green Power SPA, is a geothermal, working for Geothermal Center of Excellence, ENEL Green Power. He will start the discussion with an overview of geothermal development. And following Dr. Bertani, Professor Roland, Horne, professor of Stanford University, will give a talk on the latest technology development of EGS and other things. And following Professor Horne, Dr. Isao Matsunaga, president of Geothermal Research Society of Japan, and also Emeritus Researcher of National Institute of Advanced Industrial Science and Technology, as I am working, will then talk about situation in Japan. And following Dr. Matsunaga, Dr. Bjarni Bjarnason, CEO of Reykjavik Energy, will then make a speech on geothermal utilization in Iceland. Following that, after a short interlude, we will hold a 50-minute panel discussion, not 50-minute discussion. We will also open up the floor to questions. We would be most delighted if you too could put forward your opinion and make contribution to the discussion. Let's make today's discussion a fruitful one together. Thank you. So let me introduce the first speaker, Dr. Ruggero Bertani from Italy.
thanks for this kind invitation. It's a real pleasure for me to present some information on the highlights about the geothermal development in the world. I'm Ruggero Bertani. I'm working in ENEL Green Power in the Geothermal Center of Excellence in Pisa. That's me for the Japanese audience. My company is one of the leading companies in the world for renewable energy. We are active in North America, North South America, in Europe, mainly for producing 100% of renewable energies for a total 8.9 gigawatt. And you see basically where we are and the different splits of our activity in solar, geothermal, and wind, mainly. And also we are in an important growing phase with the target of reaching in the next 5 years 20 gigawatt, so going more than double of the present installed capacity with a global investment of 5.4 billion of euro in several areas of the world, mainly North America and Italy, Europe, but also what we call emerging market, which is from our business perspective, Africa. But let's be focused on geothermal energy. You see here an history of geothermal energy development for the electricity production, and there was a quite important stable growing till today with approximately 13 gigawatt of installed capacity, and a forecast for the next 5 years with a minimum of 15 gigawatt and a maximum 22. And this value has been made by me according to several information, and is also basically confirmed by an independent assessment of Bloomberg New Energy Finance, which evaluated a total of 20 gigawatt of geothermal potential for the short term from the present value of approximately 10, which is the 48% of the commissioned plant, to all the other projects that are at different stage, permitted, announced, under construction, but all the projects behind the 20 gigawatt are named. It's not only a general reserve or resource or potential, but projects. So you see the present geothermal world with the different countries, different color, highlighting the growing phase. Let me just highlight two important countries, which is Turkey and Kenya, where from basically almost nothing, just a few tenths of megawatt of 5 or 6 years ago, was an impressive growing with several players and different companies working and drilling and building plant just in a really impressive growing phase. And again, below you see the total for the world with the 15 and 22 value. So you see again the same data from a long-term perspective, starting from the beginning with the 15 and 22 value. And what we can see from this growing curve, that basically geothermal development was under three ages. There was the age of the lion, the first impressive exponential beginning, a roaring lion, aggressive, able to catch the easy animals in the savanna, plenty of resources and a lot of possibility. And now we are living in the age of the turtle with a slow, linear growing phase, trying to keep the market with a continuous but modest increase. If going along the turtle step or the turtle speed, we reach the 15 megawatt or the 13 from the 15 gigawatt from the 13 gigawatt that we have now. So if you want to have the exponential growth, it's necessary to open the new age, I say the age of the fox. It's necessary to be smart and fast. Fast for because the market is fast growing, smart because the resources are not so easy to find. There are a lot of difficulties and a lot of problems that require a lot of intelligence, business intelligence, research, innovation, and experience to catch the right possibility and the right opportunities. So basically, we want an exponential growing or geothermal. There are several pillars. The first is the resource availability. It's important to work where the geothermal is and to find new resources. The environmental constraints are one of the most important limits and they should be handled in a proper way. The economics in terms of cost and revenues from the geothermal activity. The social aspect that are also important. We learned this morning from the Toyota key speaker that the social aspect of the consumer behavior was one of the key successes of the previous experience. So the social or the consumer attitude is really important. The demand, there is no development if there is no enough demand of the resource. And the opportunities, we need to be on the market in the real time, on the real phase. So basically, all these activities are summarized in this table, where there are several points that should be addressed, how to cope with each one of the pillars, and several actions that are needed, let's say, for instance, from the resources, research and development, coordination of activity for the environment is again technological solution and also architectural solution from the power plant. For the economics is important, several coordination and bank financing. For the social is the creation of consensus between population, and for the demand is planning the project in the right position, in the right site. So basically, the technology is one of the most important aspects. And you see just a short history of the technology. We started from different plants, the dry steam and the flash plant and the binary. Now, for the long-term outlook, there are several new aspects, which are not completely new, like a binary plant. The EGS is one of the other options. The development of supercritical fluid is then unconventional new research, and of course the cascade utilization and the hybridization all together will help to reach the important growing according to the Fox style. So the binary plant is really important. I show some of the examples with my companies involved in. That's our binary plant, say, traditional standard binary plant in Nevada. It's a 12 megawatt turbine with me. That's another development. It was the first binary plant that has been built in Italy. It's completely different because it's using steam instead of hot water. So there is a flash and a binary plant. So some technological solution that help to apply the binary plant technology in different and also complex from a chemical point of view situation. So there's some photo of the binary 3 power plant, and the new binary plant is 1 megawatt. It's small, but it's important to get the energy from the separated fresh water. And also a new experimental binary plant using a supercritical fluid. This is a 250 kilowatt. It's small, but it was an experimental plant that has been realized in our laboratory and tested in the Livorno experimental site. With using different fluid and different cycles with the target of increase from, let's say, 8.5 megawatt to 10.1 megawatt in the standard condition. So with something like 15 or 10% higher efficiency in comparison with that. It's a small increase, but still you see an area where the research can produce some improvement even with a long-lasting technology. The EGS is will be covered by Professor Horne, just some photo about the European project of Sulz. That's the latest photo that I have. And I want to spend some minutes about the hybrid plant. There is a project in Stillwater in Nevada where there was a geothermal plant of 33 megawatt. and it was an area in the middle of the desert full of sun. So we installed a photovoltaic of 26 megawatt photovoltaic panel in order to increase the energy output of the system. And what you see is from this picture here, how the photovoltaic is, working in synergy with the geothermal, because when there is more sun, the geothermal is less efficiency because of the outside air temperature or the cooling leg. So photovoltaic, solar, and geothermal are perfectly complementary on a daytime basis and also on a year time basis. And that was a first step. You see the photo of the power plant with the photovoltaic. But also we are doing a second step, increasing the efficiency with solar heating thermodynamic plant with parabolic in order to increase the temperature of the geothermal fluid from the well. You can up them and to increase the enthalpy and the production. So you see there are total 17 thermal megawatt. And again, you see here, on a year basis, the electrical output from the solar thermal, and in the year basis, the geothermal output going up and down from winter to summer, and it's going down and up from winter to summer. Again, an impressive average coverage. So the hybridization geothermal plus solar is proven, is important, and is available for give some extra value of the geothermal area. There is also another option of hybridization. We have a biomass boiler, increasing the enthalpy of the steam from the well in a geothermal plant. That's in Cornea. So we increased the capacity of approximately 5 gigawatt from burning biomass crop and using the additional heat to increase the geothermal, the output of the geothermal turbine. And in this case, the critical point is the economics. You see the investment return value as a function of the electricity selling revenue with 150 euro per megawatt hour. The return is only 5%, which is not feasible. With a value around 200, it's 15%, which is much more acceptable. In Italy, the feed-in tariff is 120, so it's something like that. It's a little bit less, but there are some additional, incentive. Also, the cogeneration is using the geothermal heat not only for electricity, but also for district heating, for agricultural application, for different step cascade utilization. And all together are widely used in Italy and in many other countries in the world for increasing the energy output, the overall energy output of the cycle. So we are going to the last minute. And the last minute will be devoted to the unconventional, which will be the supercritical fluid. You see a photo of how a supercritical system looks like that's taken by geothermal. And in Larderello, we have a supercritical fluid hosted in the K horizon, which is a seismic reflector in depth. And we have, there were several projects in the world that reached or tried to reach supercritical fluid. One is San Pompeo. One is Kakonda, which is well known here in Japan, and one is the Icelandic project. And our new project in Larderello is called Discrumble, is trying to reach the K horizon with an expected temperature of 450 degrees and expected the pressure 250 bar of 25 megapascal for supercritical fluid with the possibility of producing up to 30 megawatt per single geothermal well. So that would be really important. You see the map with the location of the well and the drilling design. and the consortium that we are going to do. So if it will be possible to reach the solution, will be possible to increase impressive the output from a single well and also the cost. So the success of this research will open great perspective for geothermal energy. That's all. Thanks for your kind attention.
Thank you, Ruggero. And please say some comments or questions. Now the discussion is open to the floor. It's a good chance to ask our guest from Italy. You introduced some systems like cogeneration, and is this kind of works are done in your company also?
Yes, yes.
So it's commercially feasible. That
it's commercially feasible, especially from agricultural application. We are feeding with our steam several greenhouses and also for district heating. I don't remember exactly the figure, but it's more than 50 district heating, measured district heating of villages or small communities, and also even a single group of factories or countryside that are fed by geothermal steam for heat. And also some industrial application in terms of food treatment. Mm-hmm. So it's commercial.
I see.
And also I can add, is so valuable in terms of economics that is creating a lot of indirect jobs.
Indirect jobs.
Indirect jobs, yes. For people not involved in geothermal, but let's say, for instance, for the there is a milk treatment factory producing cheese, and it would not exist before. It has been created in that area only because of the presence of low-cost heat, which costs much less than a standard
boiler.
Uh-huh. Yes, exactly. Uh-huh. And it has created something, 10 or 12 people working, and a new job created for the presence of the available heat at low cost in an area where it's not so easy to bring other fuel.
I see. So do you have any questions to Dr. Roger Bertani? Oh, here, yeah, please.
Sven Grandin from the Norwegian Embassy in Tokyo. I have a question regarding the size of geothermal plants, small scale, decentralized units, binary systems, for that sake, versus the megawatt scale, where I guess the environment assessment is more severe and probably also the time for building the plant. How do you see the developments yeah, versus each other?
Okay, of course, a big plant has some problem in terms of authorization, not in terms of construction, because when you start the erection, you can conclude a 20 megawatt plant in less than 1 year. When the paperwork would take 5 years, is done. And in terms of land occupation, a small plant is much more easily embedded in the territory. And we are planning to install a small plant of a 5 megawatt size, binary plant, in the surrounding area of the Larderello complex, in the middle of Tuscany, because of the low temperature fluid. So basically, I can answer that the best choice should be driven by the thermodynamic. The temperature of the fluid and the availability of the fluid will guide you to the selection of the proper site. It's not something that cannot be decided a priori, but tuned on specific. I personally believe that placing small power plant nearby the town, where you can use cascade heat to do district heating or just spa or whatever, is one of the key for the success of geothermal, mainly for the aspect of the social acceptance to create something which is comfort and usable, still I'm using the Toyota words.
Oh, okay.
And drivable, but I cannot be drivable.
All right, thank you very much, Dr. Roger Bertani. Okay, now we'd like to proceed to the next speaker, Professor Roland Horne from Stanford University, USA. Please.
All right, good afternoon, and thank you for coming. I'd like to also thank the organizers of this meeting for the invitation and the opportunity to speak here this afternoon. So I'm going to talk mostly about enhanced geothermal systems. That was the request by the organizers. Before doing so, I'd like to point out the position from which I make this address. I was, for the last 3 years until 2013, the president of the International Geothermal Association, which represents the geothermal associations of 35 countries of the world. So I'm going to talk today in four parts. First of all, I'll talk a little bit in general about geothermal activity in the United States. I'll talk about some innovations also in general being taking place again in the United States. I'm going to focus on EGS in the world and finally on EGS in the United States. So importantly, the reason I'd like to begin by talking about geothermal in general is if we look at the activity of the United States at the present time, what you'll see is there are 147 projects under development, and importantly, only three of them are enhanced geothermal systems. So in spite of the fact that I'm asked to talk on that subject today, and it is certainly an important subject from the point of view of the future for geothermal energy, it represents, in fact, a very small part of the activity of the geothermal community, not only in the United States, but in the world as a whole. And I'd like to draw your attention to some numbers that I think are particularly relevant to the discussion and the theme of ICEF. My state, the state of California, in 2010 generated 6% of its electricity from geothermal sources. This is not megawatts installed, but gigawatt hours actually produced. So geothermal is a very important part of the mix of the state of California. The state of California has 30 million people, and it has a grid. You can see there the total 200,000 gigawatt hours produced in the state during that year. More importantly, however, in the actual percentage game is the state of Nevada, which, as you see, also produced 6% of its electricity from geothermal energy in 2010, and that represented a significant fraction of all of the renewable energy in the state. Both states, California and Nevada, have a renewable portfolio standard of a similar size. The reason Nevada is important is because the quality of the resources in the state of Nevada is much lower than those in the state of California. We have high temperature in the state of California. Nevada has much more modest temperatures, and therefore Nevada is more a vision of the future for geothermal as it represents what can be done with, I won't say mediocre resources, but less generous resources than we have in the state of California. And this is a snapshot of the renewable energy generation in the state. This is an hour-by-hour snapshot. I took this just randomly on July 11th. And you can see the importance of geothermal in the renewable output of the state. Also importantly, you notice on that particular day, this is at lunchtime, the state of California was generating 22.5% of its electricity from renewable sources, excluding hydroelectric, which is also quite a large fraction. Now, I'd also like to point out or emphasize a point made by my friend and colleague, Dr. Bertani, that when we talk about enhanced geothermal systems, we can enhance geothermal systems in many ways. And hybridization, as he discussed, is one of them. This is a combined or hybrid solar thermal geothermal in El Salvador. This is the same plant he showed you in Stillwater, which is at that time photovoltaic and geothermal. And at the moment, as he pointed out, they're now adding concentrating solar to that plant. But the focus of my discussion here today is supposed to be about enhanced geothermal systems, so I'm going to move to that. And in general, when different people mean different things when they talk about enhanced geothermal systems. But for the most part, we're talking about reservoirs in which among the three principal requirements of a geothermal system, heat, water and permeability, either the water or the permeability or both are absent. So in order to bring a full system, we enhance the permeability and may also perhaps add water. in a system known previously as hot dry rock, now more commonly known as enhanced or engineered geothermal systems. The idea is that we drill one well and produce fractures in a reservoir which is otherwise relatively unfractured. We drill a second well to intersect those fractures and pass the water between them. If we look at drillable depth in the continental United States, you can see that a very significant fraction of the U.S. has temperatures larger than 150 degrees centigrade at 6 kilometer depth, which is currently drillable depth. So by that mechanism, enhanced geothermal systems, we should be able to produce geothermal energy in places that are not as well endowed as the state of California in terms of the optimum temperatures and permeability. And in fact, in an important report by MIT in 2007, they suggested that with enhanced geothermal systems, the nation as a whole, the nation of the United States, could enjoy the 5 or 6% generation from geothermal sources that California and Nevada now enjoy. Let me be honest with you, however, there is some difficulties in achieving that. And let's talk about what those are. In order for an enhanced geothermal system to be effective, it must achieve a surface-to-volume ratio which is small. That is, a large volume and a small surface. The point is that conduction is a very poor mechanism of energy transport, and if we rely on conduction alone, we cannot get sufficient production of energy from the system. We have to make contact with large volumes of rock with our fractures. And the technological requirement then is therefore to create a fracture network which has an optimal connection with the hot rock through which it needs to pass. That's the first requirement. Second requirement is actually to be able to understand what fracture network we have created at 5 kilometers under the ground where we can't see it. It's commonly proposed and understood that a geothermal well should produce, to be economic, about 80 kilograms per second. And to put that in the context of oil and gas production, if you're coming from that point of view, 80 kilograms per second is 50,000 barrels per day of fluid. We do have oil wells in the planet that produce 50,000 barrels per day, but they are very few in number. 50,000 barrels per day is a very large amount of fluid. And geothermal wells all have to produce that kind of level in order to make money. The principal reason is simple, that hot water or steam has a much lower energy density than hydrocarbons such as oil and natural gas. Therefore, you must produce a lot in order to have the energy requirement we need. A fourth difficulty that we should also talk about importantly is induced seismicity. There has been a waning of public interest and acceptance of geothermal energy because of a few famously difficult seismic events associated with the geothermal developments. I'll talk about that in a little while. So this is an excerpt from the MIT report that shows the actual cost expectation with 80 kilograms per second. This is a projection. In practice, this is not an EGS well, but this is just a normal, ordinary geothermal well of the type that Dr. Bertani showed you. This particular one was producing a total flow of about 70 kilograms per second. So certainly with conventional geothermal resources, we can attain those productions without difficulty. If, on the other hand, we look at enhanced geothermal systems, of which there have been several experimental research sites around the world, it's not been so easy. This particular one is from Sultz in France. And what you can see here is that the actual amount being produced in this particular test was about 10 kilograms per second. Here's an example from here in Japan, the Hijiori plant, which at this time was also producing a little less than 10 kilograms per second. A more recent plant in Cooper Basin in Australia, when they first drilled the well, they were able to sustain 20 kilograms per second. They squeaked it up to 30 kilograms per second before the well itself failed. They drilled a new well in 2012 and ultimately achieved 35 kilograms per second. So certainly technological advances have improved. We are yet in this kind of system, however, to achieve the 80 kilograms per second I referred to. That would seem discouraging, except that, in fact, those kind of production rates have been achieved in enhanced geothermal systems. This particular one is really perhaps the first commercial EGS system in the world. It's in Landau, Germany, and they produce 70 kilograms per second of 175 degree fluid to generate 3 megawatts of electricity. That plant was put in line in 2007. Unfortunately, in March of this year, the plant was suspended, and the reason for the suspension was public opinion and the withdrawal of support from the city of Landau, which is close by, due to ground deformation and earthquakes. So that emphasizes the point that the geomechanical problem needs to be understood and also needs to be well explained to the public in order for this kind of system to gain public acceptance. And to emphasize another point, I mentioned before, this is actually the border. France is on the left and Germany is on the right. This is the Rheingraben. Sulz and Rittershofen are actually in France. Landau and Insheim, Insheim is another operating plant too, are both in Germany. So those are worthwhile sites from the point of view of what they mean to the history of the development. But it's important to note that they're all in the same place. So in other words, in terms of innovation, if you like, although these plants are all different, they really didn't step out very far from each other. Landau and Sulz are only 40 kilometers apart from each other. And geologically, they're very similar. So here are some of the examples. So I showed you there Landau and Sulz. Each of them have or were generating in the recent past. Insheim is another one which has been operating for the last 2 years. It's a somewhat larger plant. In fact, it's the largest EGS plant in the world, producing 4.8 megawatts. And currently under development is Rittershofen, which will not generate electricity at all. It is generating thermal energy only, or it will when it's finished next year. Now let me switch to my final topic, which is the United States. There have been in the recent past 5 experimental projects using EGS in these places that you see listed. Importantly, most of these are not EGS in the context that I described to you earlier with the two wells and passing fluids in between. Newbury in Oregon, this one in the middle, is of that kind. The other 4, however, are mostly stimulation of wells on the outskirts of conventional geothermal fields. So once again, if you like, this is innovation, but in a very small step. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. If we're going to make changes and develop new technologies, it's certainly worthwhile to begin with technologies we already know in places that we understand already geologically. That's an important part. But let me talk about Newbury, because Newbury is, in fact, a conventional or classical enhanced geothermal system. They took over 2 wells which had been drilled for conventional geothermal but abandoned because they were too impermeable. The temperatures are extremely high, 300 degrees centigrade, and they drilled and stimulated their first well and are about to, actually going to re-stimulate at this moment. They're in the process of stimulating a second time right now, after which they will drill their production well. And importantly in Newbury, they are using a technology which has not been applied before. So in terms of innovation in EGS, this is really it. And I hope you noticed in the vote that you're required to make on the innovative technologies for renewable energies, there's only one of them that applies to geothermal energy, and actually this is it. So I hope after I've described it to you, you can record your vote. The emphasis I've made is the achievement of that 80 kilograms per second, as well as the surface-to-volume ratio that allows you to contact large volumes of rock. if you do the classical kind of stimulation, such as was done in Hideyori and was done in salts and pretty much all of the others too, you simply don't get enough contact. And you spend so much money on the well that it doesn't pay off economically. What they're doing in the Newbury project is different. They stimulate the well several times. And the process is to begin, they stimulate one fracture, and then having stimulated, they fill it up again. They plug it with a temporary material known as zonal isolation material. It's actually a polymer that you see in here. So having plugged the first fracture, they stimulate again, and then stimulate a second fracture. They plug again with that material and then stimulate a third fracture. And this material, because it degrades with temperature, ultimately it will disappear, and all three stages of stimulation will remain present. So that's an innovation which brings to bear increased flow rate, first of all, for the same number of wells, as well as surface-to-volume contact ratio. So to conclude, I haven't shown it here today, but Dr. Bertani did. In the last 5 years, or actually the last 10 years since 2005, a big increase in development of geothermal worldwide, principally as a function of the interest in renewable energy in general and renewable protocol standards and things like that. New technologies like the hybrid plants we've talked about have been implemented. There have been several others as well. EGS is a potential for us to foresee the future of geothermal in the US and in other places too. Technically, the main difficulty is getting sufficient flow so that the project will be cost effective. And we also need to understand the geomechanical problem, because otherwise induced seismicity is going to kill public acceptance of this idea, and we would not be able to go it forward. So with that, I conclude, and thank you.
Thank you, Professor Horne. And we have 5 minutes for discussion and questions. So please, yes, please.
This Alta Rock project, I'm not very good informed, but I saw that this fracturing occurs in a way that you have a packers which isolate some section of the borehole, and the pressure is increased in only in that section, and then you simply move packers to other section of the borehole and try to fracture another part. So what is the advantage of this zonation approach?
Yes, so let me first of all answer, there are no packers in the Alta Rock project. It's done without packers, and that's commonly the case in geothermal at these kinds of temperatures. The process you describe is commonly applied in shale gas fracturing, where they have multi-stage fracturing, where they move the packers. But in this kind of environment, that is not the case. The principal reason why is because most geothermal wells in volcanic environments have temperatures that are too high for the polymers of the packers. So the well that I showed you is 300 degrees centigrade, so that's quite far beyond the capacity of common oilfield packers. Furthermore, because the well is open hole completion instead of a cased hole, which is more commonly used in oil and gas, and because it's volcanic, a very brittle kind of rock, the surface of the hole is not smooth, and therefore it's very difficult, not impossible, but very difficult to pack geothermal wells because of the temperature and because of the roughness of the hole, and therefore the generation of this idea.
My name is Haruya Nakata of GLD. And I was in charge of Hijori Hot Rock project in the past when I was young. And thank you very much for your presentation. But, I'd like to comment about the definition of EGS today. Because you told me that EGS was known as hotline log. But I think this explanation is always make some confusion. So I'd like to make it clear this point. I think EGS includes hotline log, I agree, but EGS is not same as hotline log. I think, do you agree?
Yes, you're correct.
Yes, okay. And according to US DOE and EGS is a technology to create engineered reserve to small, low temperature and small permeability. So I think that EGS includes not only hot rock, but also covers stimulation, such as hydraulic fraction, or sometimes water injection to natural reservoir. So do you agree this point?
Yes, quite correct.
Okay.
So as I pointed out, the five EGS projects in the US, Newbury is what we would have previously called hot dry rock. The other four are stimulation, more or less. And the point of confusion, just to clarify the point, which is well made, 20, 30 years ago, the only enhanced geothermal systems were hot dry rock. But nowadays, we have other kinds as well. So there is some overlap of understanding. People who don't go into it so deeply may confuse the two. Hot dry rock was an enhanced geothermal systems, but the enhanced or engineered geothermal systems we talk about today include other kinds as well. You're quite correct.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Toshitoshi from Jokomek. And I think the induced seismicity is a very big problem between US and Japan, also other countries. Do you have some idea to suppress some induced seismicity, or do you have some technology to predict the induced earthquakes using the simulation or some geomechanical systems?
Yes, I perhaps should have mentioned that. The problem is not completely without understanding. We have considerable advances in geomechanical simulation, geomechanical modeling. And in fact, we now have a much clearer understanding of what causes the induced seismicity and how we could make it less. So, for example, it's been seen in very many cases that the seismicity is actually greater after you stop injecting than it was during injection. And the reasons for that actually are now understood, and the way to avoid it is also understood. The point being is that if you inflate or increase the pressure of the fracture and then stop, that's the normal practice in oil and gas, because you want all of that hydraulic energy in the reservoir to do useful things. In fact, that's a bad idea when it comes to shear, unlike oil and gas, which is tensile fracturing. In shear fracturing, if you leave the pressure high, that pressure dissipates along the length of the fracture. You then have a much larger surface of the fracture, which is then open to shear. Then you get a bigger event after you stop. The solution to that is, once you stop injecting, release the pressure, and then, in fact, you should not produce such large events.
Thank you very much.
Again. So thank you very
thank
much,
you.
Professor Horne. So let me introduce the next speaker, Dr. Isao Matsunaga. He is the president of Geothermal Research Society of Japan.
I see the many friends in here. Maybe I left the AST 3 years ago, and now my job is to choose some of the prize for the science and technology. So some of the people around here known very well than me. But so I mainly said the current status of the geothermal development in Japan, general things, and then I moved in the hot dry rock research development in Japan until the 10 years ago. First, I should say the Japan is the very some of the characterized the special tectonical situations. There are the three plate plate merged to the one place, and then we have the three subduction zones along the Japan islands and also the southern islands like this. That makes the quite many volcanoes along the main island. One is here and the other one here. These subduction zones are different. You know, the Pacific plate is slightly older than the Philippine plate and merge, go into the Eurasian plate. Philippine plate go into the also the Eurasian plate, but the speed is different, and also the angle is different. So some of the characters along the this side and this side is differs the volcanoes. And also the this volcano is quite active. You know, the 2 weeks ago, last September 26th, and one Ontake erupted, and we had a big disaster. Over the 50 people died at the mountain. However, we also have the quite high geothermal heat from the these volcanoes. This this figure compiled by the Sakaguchi and Takahashi of the AST. This is the some of the conceptual modeling of the geothermal resources in Japan. So the geothermal resources in Japan are very close to the quaternary volcano. Also, we have this slightly older volcanoes. So mainly this part is the produced the hydrothermal systems, convection systems beneath the volcanic area. So we have the quite big resource of the geothermal. And some of the low temperature hot water located beneath the some of the quaternary sedimentary formation. But usually we don't use this side. So we should say the we have the quite big resources potential of the world third potential of the geothermal that over the just the 20 gigawatt of the resource just after the Indonesia, US. So we have the quite big potential, but only the we have at now 20 geothermal power plants are in operation at the these 17 locations, mainly in Tohoku area and the Kyushu area. One is in Hokkaido and one is in Hachijojima. These geothermal power plants generate the 526 megawatt capacity. That only the 0.2% of the total power generation in Japan. So compared to the our geothermal potential, resources potential, actual produced electricity is quite small. We should need the to some of the future development. I just showed the here the some of the chronology from the beginning of the, our geothermal development. In 1966, first geothermal power plant in Matsunaga start operation, and then geothermal power plant increased at this part in around the 1980s. That come out from the some of the big effort from the private companies at starting point. And then that stabilized again the another big increase occurred in around the 1995. That's come from the mainly the government support promote the development under the Sunshine Project. These programs they initiate after the oil crisis. Government put the many budget to input the promote the renewable energy, also the coal liquefaction and the gasification. So there are some of the steps. But after that, unfortunately, the capacity is stabilized from the 1996 until now. And this line shows the power produced there annually. That increased up to the 1997, and after that gradually decreased, unfortunately. These years, the, we had the severe time to keep the activities mainly in companies and also the research part. In 2011, after the big earthquake in East Japan occurred, the government again to push the force to the renewable energy introduction. So now the some of the quite big effort just restart. I show the two photos. This is the first oldest power plant in Japan, the Matsukawa, that's located in northern Iwate Prefecture. You see the small power plant in the small valleys. Other one, this is the biggest power plant in Kyushu, Hachobaru Josama power plant. That generate the 112 megawatt of the electricity just the middle of the Kyushu area. So I already said you the we had the some of the peak production, also the installed capacity that here is the 1995 and 1996, and then the gradually decreased. Other countries, especially the, you know, the Iceland, Indonesia, New Zealand, also the some of the Mexico's, that increased after the 2000. But only in one country decreased the generation. But I already told you the we restart the, some of the promotion after the big earthquake disaster. The Ministry of Environment start the estimate the geothermal potential in Japan again. The, we already had the rough the potential. Ministry of Environment calculate. Estimate using the sum of the land use and regulations access from the main part. And then they estimate the potential resources are quite big. And then this is the very important numbers, potential for developing. We estimate the, let me see, 63.6 gigawatt for the above the 150 C's fluid, high temperature fluid. We also have the some of the numbers, especially the below the 120 degrees C, the, we have the quite big numbers of the potential for the also the electricity, or not exactly electricity, heat, energy. So we should develop this one, and also we have the many, you know, the hot springs that the supply that these numbers very close to there. And we have still the some of the big troubles, but this is mainly the you describe the some of the many major issues for geothermal development in Japan to the quite recently. There are the many risks to develop the underground resources. Already you know the, this. Roland said we need quite a big volumes of the hot fluid to generate the electricity from the geothermal energy. So even though the, as like the Japan, we have the, we should have quite a big hot water from the underground under the very complex geology in Japan. Also, we have the quite big numbers of the hot springs along the volcanoes. So they already had many hot springs in some very famous areas. So there's some of the local people against to develop the geothermal power plant. So we should negotiate. Actually, we issue the report from the Geological Research Society of Japan, issued the report to title that this one, collaboration with the hot springs and power generation. And also, already Roland said the risks of the seismic hazards. Besides these two, also we have the quite big trouble, actually the restrictions of the national parks. Many volcanoes are located in the national parks. Actually, the close to the 80% of the geothermal resources are located in national reserves of the parks. So when we promote the further geothermal power plant, we should need some of the negotiation and some of the mitigation to the environmental or environmental viewpoint or environmental assessment, something like that. I already showed this geothermal power plant before the the national parks law restrictions. There are some of the geothermal power plant already developed in these colors. But after that, these green colors geothermal power plant are built outside of the geothermal national parks. So when we find out the quite nice high entropy resources, it's very difficult to outside the national parks. So we should negotiate or some technology to access to the national parks, high temperature zones. Fortunately, Ministry of Environment slightly mediate the regulations. They approve the some of the access outside the national parks going to the beneath the national parks by the inclined extended drilling, and some of the small wells there, I hope the permit inside the some of the zones in national parks. Also, Minister Meti support the strong finance to promote the geothermal, like this subsidiary for the geological survey and investment for exploration drilling, and also the loan guarantees for drilling this. These are many the go into the some of the realization the last 3 years after the 2011 the big earthquake. And also that time the feed-in tariff schemes are introduced for the all renewable energy. Before that, the renewable portfolio standard they applied by the government, but that time the geothermal energy is very severe to outside the that portfolio. Only the binary cycle power generation is approved. So that time the, it's very hard to develop the geothermal energy. And after that, this feed-in tariff scheme introduced the many companies restart the development now. This is the total. last two years project supported by JOGMEC. We compared, compared to the national resources potential, we only the sum of the quite small part is developed now. So I hope the mainly the Hokkaido and also the you know, the Aomori, this part, the already developing part now. So we hope the we have the quite big numbers of the geothermal activities. The other one, this is the some of the power production of the all geothermal power plant in Japan. Some of the geothermal power plant declined the production at here. Some of the geothermal power plant keep the activity. So we should consider that this part. Such case, the some of the EGS technologies should be applied. I skipped this one already, Roland said. After Hijiori, we conducted the photo dialogue technology development until the 2002. We conducted the 2 years circulation. We had two reservoir fracture inside the caldera. We have two, but actually that these very complex fracture systems that there. There are some of the difficulties for the operate the HDR project, heat extraction from reservoirs. One is the difficult in reservoir design, and other ones the hard to control stable circulations. We get only the less than the around the 50% of the water injected we can recover at the Hijiori, Ogachi areas, much less than 1/3 of the fluid recovered from there. Okay. When we apply the hydraulic fracturing, there's very strange phenomena. Just the 300 meter depth difference, direction of the fracture extensions are quite different. One is the eastward, one is the northward. There's so strange the stress complexity. And let me see. I already said this one, we got the quite low recovery. We also, during the circulation test, we got the some of the thermal breakthrough. We originally designed this one, used the very small size of the reservoir. And we inject the several patterns and how to effect to recoveries. And we got there many things there. So from this experience, we need some of the technologies, zone isolation. Already Roland said there are some of the ideas. And we need some of these stress beneath the ground, and also the fracture system that we need. And also that we have quite a big scaling programs at the system. So we should need some controlling technologies. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Matsunaga. And we are in short of time, but just one short question would be acceptable. Okay. Okay.
My name is Eckart Hitze from the International Christian University. I wonder, you have earthquakes in Japan anyway on a regular basis. They induce seismicity from geothermal power stations. Is that comparable, or is it on a weaker level to the average earthquake seismicity in Japan?
Okay, some of the geothermal power plants. Yeah, many geothermal power plants located in the very active areas. So around there, there are some of the microseismics occurred. At the Hijori, we monitor the microearthquakes. Also, around the caldera, we detected some of the quite big numbers of the microseismics. But we cannot separate. But injection zones and production zones, there's not so many seismicities.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Matsunaga. So let me introduce our last speaker, Mr. Bjarni Bjarnason from Reykjavik Energy. Please welcome.
Ladies and gentlemen, a few words on my background. I'm a geologist and actually a marine mechanic as well, so I like drilling and geology. I've been in this geothermal for quite a while. And I'm going to give you a case story on a little island in the North Atlantic with harsh weather conditions, and show you what benefit we have gotten out of geothermal. Just the big view first. This is a very simplified calculation. Calculate the volume of the crust of the Earth. We know the temperature in the crust, and we know the specific heat content of the rocks. If we multiply this together, it shows that there's quite a bit of energy in the crust. And if we could put 0.1% of the heat energy stored in the crust to efficient work, it would be sufficient for mankind for the next 10,000 years at present usage. Just to show that it is abundant, there's only a little tiny problem to it, and that is how to get at it. Here we have two main geological settings. Where we find typically high temperature geothermal fields on the globe. And the one to the left is the situation in Japan, more or less, and the other one is the situation in Iceland. We have very favorable conditions for geothermal harnessing in Iceland, and these cannot be transferred directly to the geological circumstances and problems in Japan. And of course, geothermal is particular in the way that no two geothermal fields are alike. And each geothermal field changes also over time. This is the Icelandic setting. The island on the middle of the North or the Mid-Atlantic volcanic ridge, stretching from the North Pole to the South Pole. It's a very volcanic area. You have a some sort of a hot plume rising to the surface through the mantle underneath Iceland. It gives us a lot of heat energy. Iceland was settled 1,100 years ago by then not Icelanders, I suppose. We became Icelanders by settling down in that country. For the first 1,000 years, the volcanic activity was a curse. For the last 100 years, we have been able to turn it into a blessing. And actually, one of the best things on this island. Here you see closer view on the geology. The pink or yellow zone is the volcanic zone crossing the island where the spreading is taking place. And the red dots are active central volcanoes. We have a number of them. Now we have a big eruption going on that has been now for 1 month approximately. And with the lava covering 50 square kilometers already, 10 to 20 meters thick. It may last for the next 10 years, we don't know yet. It may also stop tomorrow. There's no way to predict. Anyway, high temperature zones are the volcanic zones, and we drill right into the volcanoes and we build our power stations on top of the volcanoes or inside the calderas. Outside, we have the black dots. These are low temperature areas, so-called low temperature, reaching up to and above 150 degrees, and the high temperatures above 250. In the beginning of the last century, there was a particular hot spring in Reykjavik that was used for laundry. This is the first use, you could say, so practical use of geothermal in Iceland. In 1930, we connected a primary school with hot water from adjacent hot springs. And this was the start of the central heating or geothermal district heating project, which has been an enormous success. And in my view, I think that the power energy society is looking far too little at the direct use of geothermal power, far too little. It is very economical in many cases. There's less environmental impact. And it's a very, very good use in these areas where heat can be used. Well, so the geothermal district heating company started 1930, 85 years back. Here you see the primary energy use in Iceland from the beginning of the Second World War, and it's been increasing rapidly, particularly over the last 10 years or so, almost vertically. And you see the extremely important role of geothermal. The biggest part of all energy used in Iceland is geothermal. And then we have hydro, which is, of course, for power production. But geothermal is for power production and direct use. Then we have oil, one-third for the road traffic, one-third for the ocean-going vessels, and one-third for the air traffic. And we are going to eliminate these as well, start by the cars and putting them over to electricity and hydrogen, and then the vessels. It's more difficult to see an electric airplane, though, yet. Who knows? Another way to cut out that would be to stop the air traffic. And this we tried back in 2010. It was not very popular when we had the volcanic eruption in Eyjafjallajökull. I cannot promise that we're not going to do it again. Yeah. This... I went the wrong way. Here we see the energy mix from 1940 to 2012. And here there's very little geothermal. It increases. And today we have, not only do we have a lot of geothermal, but we have moved up to 86% of renewable energy of the total energy usage of that country. This is probably unique. The geothermal blessing, 90% of houses are heated with geothermal in Iceland. And it supplies 30% of the electricity production. The rest is hydro power, So 100% of the power generation is renewable as well. It is very low cost. It gives us an energy independence, which is quite important for an isolated island. It has small environmental footprint, particularly for direct use, and it has wide public acceptance for the direct use. There's more question about the power station for producing electricity. Here is one example. This is in Reykjavik. The red dot here is the Japanese embassy, and the blue rings show geothermal wells for district heating. And the bottom temperature is 125 to 30 degrees, and it produces 330 liters of very good quality water per second. And each of these wells is more valuable than an oil well in the long run. The water is too hot to be pumped directly into the houses, so we have a part of Reykjavik with a double system. We take the returning water at 35 degrees, mix it with this water, then we pump it out to houses at 80, 85 degrees centigrade. This is the temperature curve for Reykjavik from January to December, high and low. And if you look at Sapporo, it is warmer in the summer, colder in the winter. This shadow area shows the part of the year, approximately half of the year, when it's colder or much colder in Sapporo than in Reykjavik. So you could easily use geothermal for house heating or direct use in Japan to a much greater extent than what is done today. Here you see Japan with 127 million people. The size here shows the total use of direct use of geothermal energy. And Japan uses 2,100 megawatts thermal, Iceland almost 2,000, 0.3 million people, 127 million people. So you have a long way to go yet. And then you see how this is divided. In our case, the 76% space heating. And again, this is direct use. Electricity is not in this picture. In Japan, bathing is over 80%, and space heating is only 4%. well, the heating utility is my company runs a heating district heating utility. It's the largest company in Iceland in that business. We are big on the Icelandic market. We serve about two-thirds of Iceland with cold water and hot water, power distribution, and so forth. But internationally, we are very, very small because utilities tend to be giants. There are many other smaller companies in Iceland giving these services. They typically municipally owned or state-owned. We have legalized monopoly. Very, very low cost, regulated, stable profits. so one important thing that has been mentioned here that is open access to data. That's a very important thing in utilizing geothermal. The government has come up with risk-reducing incentives with guarantees or on loans and subordinated loans. Grants for small communities and individuals to do test drilling, and there's no result, there's no pay. And at the end of the day, in total, the sector as such is very economical. this is policy and incentives by the government. I'm not going to dwell on this. Just to show you here that district heating is quite common in the world. And then I'm not talking about geothermal. If you have a district heating system in St. Petersburg or wherever, it is not complicated to turn, if they had a geothermal resource, it's not complicated to turn geothermal water on. So district heating and geothermal district heating are very related. In the latter case, the heat energy is just coming from the ground. Here we have the major geothermal companies, and this is power production. And if I, this is Reykjavik Energy. If we add to that the thermal, then we might say that we are in total the largest, single largest geothermal company in the world. And again, that is because geothermal companies are very, very small. As I said, we produce hot water and cold water, electricity, sewage services we have, and even fiber optics. This is in one of our power plants. This is Mr. Nobuteru Ishihara, I think it's his name, the environmental minister on visit last summer. And we apply Japanese technology. We have altogether, we have 10 turbines from Mitsubishi, 30 megawatts, four of them, and six of 45 megawatts, one from Toshiba. Hadley say that this power plant is 303 megawatts in power and 133 in thermal, going up to 400, so it's going to be 700 megawatts altogether. It is now in full production and excellent mechanical health. Here you see the availability of turbine units over the year. And availability is, this is including the scheduled outages for maintenance. If you take that away, the availability is 99% in every case. Extremely reliable, run around the clock every day of the year, so it's a beautiful base load. Then the cost, energy prices in the Nordic countries, if you look at Reykjavik and you compare to Copenhagen, Stockholm, etc. And it's the same comparison, 100 square meter apartment, which is 45 tatami, if I'm right, in Japan. And the power cost is 6,000 yen per month, which is similar to one bottle of bad whiskey. That's all. And the heat, this is the power. And if you look at the space heating, it's particularly economical if you compare to the other capitals. The economic benefits of the geothermal in Iceland in the year 2010 were equivalent to $600 million for a nation of only 300,000 people. And that equals 5% of the GDP. 5%. I think that is quite unique. This is Reykjavik in 1933, coal-fired heating. And this is Reykjavik today. There are challenges, of course, and we love them. That's, that's one of the exciting things about geothermal. There are always challenges. And once when I was asked about our experience in geothermal, I said, when we started 100 years ago, we made a long list of all the possible mistakes we could do, and we've done them all. And we learned from them, hopefully. And combined, we call this experience. Cost and exploration risk is always in every geothermal project. That is inevitable. The resource balance, not to over-exploit, that's a common challenge. Induced seismicity, we've had that in this power plant for the first time. We had induced seismicity. In our case, the key to reducing it is not to play with the ground. You start injecting slowly, you increase slowly, and when you come up to a certain level, you stay there. So it's just as bad to stop pumping as to abruptly start pumping. All changes in water pressure down in the reservoir are not popular. Then we have H2S emissions. That's a big issue, and we are probably just about to solve it in our way. We scrub it out by a scrubber system. We mix H2S into cold water or the effluents from the power station, and then we pump it back down to 1,000 meters depth in the reservoir. And we have a pilot plant running that cleans out 30% of all H2S from this 400 megawatt power plant, and it very effectively eats the H2S, and it goes back into the bedrock where it crystallizes and precipitates like the mineral pyrite. And so that's the end of the story. It's not coming to the surface. It's been operating for half a year, and if it continues this way, we'll build a second module and until we cleaned out all H2S from the plant. And that's quite a success. Disposal of geothermal fluids, we have to pump down everything that comes up down into the aquifer or to the reservoir, and then general environmental housekeeping. Just to show you that environmental protection and in this case, a UNESCO World Heritage listed site can well go hand in hand with the utilization of the geothermal resource. Few pictures finally, and then I'm finished. Geothermal is beautiful, isn't it? Yes. Another station, and we have many places. We have developed natural baths in with the effluents from the power stations. This is the most popular place in Iceland, and one of the top 10 list, I think, by Planet Earth. And these are the effluents from one of the power stations. So it doesn't, it can go hand in hand to enjoy onsens in Japan and to utilize the power resource. This is in the north, inside the caldera, 30 degrees below centigrade, working day and night, and greenhouses. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bjarnason. And do you have any questions to this talk? We are a bit behind the schedule, but if you have one short question, we can accept now. Okay, thank you for your beautiful talk and beautiful pictures. So, we are behind the schedule, so we would have maybe 7 minutes for the break, and we will start the discussion at 3:45. Okay, see you later. Okay, we are missing one hour panelist, Bjarnason, so let's wait a little bit. But just waiting for him, I'd like to introduce what kind of discussion we will do. We'd like to discuss on three topics and some others. So I will tell you what are these three topics. One is future of geothermal technologies. So it's a kind of innovative technologies of geothermal utilization. And the second one is technology for more cost-effective use of conventional hydrothermal system. And the third one would be major to promote innovation of geothermal technology. So the third part would be something including social systems. So still, Bjarni is not coming, but our time is limited, so let's start our discussion now. He's coming.
I'm having coffee.
Okay. Please carry your coffee. Please have your coffee. No.
No, it's fine.
Finished? Okay. All right. Now, we would like to discuss about the future of geothermal technologies. In order to promote low-carbon society, the geothermal energy has a significant potential. The capacity of geothermal power plants is steadily expanding. Geothermal heat is also being utilized in various regions. Yet, with the consideration of capability for reduction of carbon dioxide, the geothermal energy should attain more favorable values. The main purpose of ICEF for this particular reason is to reduce carbon dioxide by year 2050 by accelerating the installation of geothermal capacity.
So what sort of innovative concept and new technology can contribute to achieve that goal? So there must be a lot of technologies, but in your presentations, some of you mentioned about EGS. So let's start with EGS.
And so I have a question for Professor Horne. Technical challenges related to EGS were shown during your presentation. Would you please provide us an outlook or forecast for making such technology into commercially viable?
Yes, so the difficulties I maintain or I talked about during my presentation are addressable from two points of view. One of them is technological, and I describe zonal isolation as one of them. Another uncertainty, however, with any kind of resource development, as pointed out by Bjarni, and I think understood by all geologists, is that the subsurface is a very uncertain environment, and no two geothermal systems are the same. Bjarni said that, and it's certainly true. The difficulty, therefore, is in developing a new technology to be able to apply it routinely in places that are inherently different from each other. And therefore, what that requires is a breadth of experience, the building of an industry around those technologies, so that the experience is gained in one place. Although they can't be used directly, they overall will advance the technology. So we have currently in the world probably a total now of as many as 10 EGS projects. That's not enough. We need 20 EGS projects or 30 EGS projects. And we also need an understanding, not only in the community but also in the government, that some of those projects will fail. And probably in the case of early projects, many of them will fail. Failed in a commercial sense is what I mean. So we talked this morning about making innovation in terms of success and failure. We need to learn from failures as well as learning from successes. We need numerical numbers of projects in order to advance the technology. We know how to do it. We just need to get experience in doing different technologies in different geological environments.
Thank you very much. And do you have any questions? By the way, I would like to tell you that please interrupt our discussion anytime you have questions or comments from the floor. So please just raise your hand when you have some questions. So do you have any questions to Roland Horne? Okay, I'd like to know more about EGS project in the world. So could you tell us the EGS project in Italy?
No, we do not have any EGS project in Italy. Basically, the Italian geothermal development is based on two aspects. One is the high temperature field, which is Larderelle Montemiata, dry steam or liquid dominated reservoir. And the second is several projects on the low temperature binary plant. We, for several reasons, not Enel or not other companies tried to afford the EGS research.
But you mentioned about supercritical,
yes,
high temperature development.
Exactly.
Is that experimental or development phase?
Okay, this brand new project is in the approval and financing phase. We made a general design of the project. It is basically drilling a medium depth well. It's 3 kilometers. It's not as deep as other in Iceland, to reach supercritical fluid. And according to our judgment, it should not be an EGS because we are planning to exploit to find some permeability and fluid. That could be basically supercritical water plus something. And we need, of course, to check and to discover which sort of a fluid, which sort of chemical, which sort of thermodynamical characteristics we are expecting from such a strong seismic signal. Mm-hmm. as Professor Horne said, is a completely risky project. We evaluated 70% of possibility of failure in terms of result, but the total budget is something like 12 million euro for the entire project, just to drill and to do all the ancillary, let's say, scientific activity before, during, and after. And if it would be financed, and we will have the answer by the end of this year, it will be drilling in 2016.
Mm-hmm. I see. It's a very challenging project.
Thank you. Uh-huh. We hope so.
Yeah. So talking about that projects, I'd like to ask Mr. Bjarnason about deep drilling project in Iceland. How about the result and what did you find out of it?
Yes, the deep drilling is quite exciting. What we are aiming at by deep drilling is going down to 4 or 5 kilometers depth.
And temperature?
And increasing the temperature, bottom hole temperature from 250 to 300 degrees as it is today in a conventional well, up to maybe between 500 and 600 degrees centigrade.
Wow.
And calculations show that this way we could up to tenfold the energy output per well. So we could get up to 50 megawatts out of one single well. Today, the average is somewhere between 5 and 6 megawatts in conventional wells. And we have been working on this project for 15 years. It's called the Icelandic Deep Drilling Project. It's an international cooperation, but the pulling horse, of course, is are the power companies in Iceland. And we drilled the first well in 2009. And I remember that project particularly well. When we came down to 2,104 meters, the drill got stuck. We were aiming for 5 kilometers. And we managed to pull out of the hole, and we sidetracked when it got down where the drill was stuck, and we sort of directionally deviate, and then we continue again. The drill got stuck again at 2,104 meters, exactly. So all the clever guys, they sat together, tried to find out what had happened. The obvious thing had happened, that we had drilled into a living magma chamber, 1,000 degrees centigrade, and we had drilled into just the fluid magma. We didn't have any sort of catastrophe or eruption through the well because the cold water that we circulated through the drill string solidified the rock at the bottom. but we had put all the masterminds of geology and geophysics and geochemistry together to select a place to drill the well down to 5 kilometers, and this was the result. Drilled straight into a magma chamber. Anyway, we have not started the second well. We have not given up, but this is very expensive. And this was in 2009, right after the crisis, the bank crisis. The well, although it is only 2,100 meters deep, it is very powerful, and it is approximately 35 to 40 megawatts, a single well. But we have not been able to connect it to a turbine and let it produce because the well head and the chemistry and such, it's too wild. We cannot tame this horse, not yet.
Oh, I see. Well, in Japan, we have such project. In 1995, we reached to the depth of 3,700 meters, and we reached the temperature higher than 500 degrees C. I'm saying higher than 500 because we put some metals in the melting point of 500 and it melted. So it should be higher than that. So the temperature is fine, but the permeability was so low, so we have to do some develop some new technologies like stimulation by EGS or something. So there are many challenges awaiting for us. And do you have any questions on EGS or deep drain kind of things? Or do you have any more further comments on that? Yeah, please.
Just to add to this, in certain areas of the world with volcanic activity and very high temperatures, like in Iceland and many other places actually, if we succeed with the deep drilling and going from 250 to 500-600, it will open up a totally new power resource. You're producing much more from each well, and you are you're getting energy, heat energy, from a much bigger volume of rock. So if we succeed in Iceland with this, then our present production of geothermal of 700 megawatts or so could easily go up to a few thousand megawatts. It's possible, but we are not there yet. But this, of course, is something so exciting that we have to continue working on it.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Yes, please.
You mentioned it's very expensive, the deep drilling. In percentage of the total investment cost for a plant, how much do you anticipate?
When I say expensive, experimental projects of this size or type are expensive. A typical well is maybe $4 million, a production well. This first well, that was a very shallow deep well, is $25-30 million. So we cannot play with many of these wells, unfortunately. But typically for a power plant, the drilling cost or the total investment might be, I haven't got the exact figure, but maybe the steam collecting system and drilling and everything, maybe 30 to 40% of the total.
Make an additional comment about the cost. Our project is less expensive than your $20 million of US dollars. It's only 12.4 million euro. It's not that lower. Mainly because we are planning to use an existing well and to deepen it, even if some of the cost for replacing the casing should be covered as if it would be a new well. But nevertheless, the evaluation is quite positive because if the system would be able to turn it into electrical power, you can really reduce by a factor two the cost, having the same cost of the surface equipment and reducing the number of wells basically from a factor five. The general cost will be reduced from a factor two.
Oh, okay.
Regarding EGS, I think degree of difficulty is depending upon the kind of EGS, I think. So hot dry rock is extremely difficult to commercialize, but hydraulic fracturing to natural fracture is not so difficult. Some part is commercialized, but I agree that Professor Horne told me so. Most important task is zone isolation first, and second one is design of fracture. But regarding of hot rock project, I think it is very difficult to detect rock property for proper design of fracture. So I think present geophysical technology such as MT, gravity, or seismic, I think is not enough sufficient for that. So how about the solution about this problem? what do you have some? I'd like to know your idea about this one.
Me too. I'd like to know the answer to that question too. I think Matsunaga-san showed a very clear picture of even a greater difficulty is that even in the same zone, in at one depth, the fractures are going north, and a shallow at a different depth they're going east. So there's clearly a difference in the stress regime, even in the same proximity at different depths. So finding the direction of the stress field, finding how the fractures are going, or finding the direction of the fractures that have gone, is currently the technology. You try something and see where it goes, and then you respond to that effect. That's actually, it seems like a trivial idea, but this is not the idea that EGS began with in the original Fenton Hill project. They predicted where the fractures would go, and they drilled two wells and tried to fracture from one to the other. What they discovered, of course, was the fractures didn't go the way that they expected them to, and the second well never saw the fractures at all. And therefore, after that time, they made a very simple change, which was to drill one well and make the fracture and find where it was, and then drill the second well in order to intersect it. So that's a good example of the understanding which has gained, made use in the future projects. It remains a difficulty, however. You can certainly do that, and I think that will be our near-term future. You produce fractures, find where they are, and then drill to intersect them. That's not the same as predicting where they will be, but anyway, I think it's, at the moment, sufficient. What we would like to do in terms of predicting the fractures is not so much the direction, but the character of the fractures. If we produce one fracture and we drill one well into either end of it, that's not going to be a sustainable system because the surface-to-volume ratio is not adequate. What we want to do is to produce a network of fractures. Zonal isolation is one way to do that. Perhaps fracturing methodology, or for that matter, even the stress regime. If we choose an appropriate stress regime, that would give rise to networks of fractures, for example, due to a combination of hydraulic or shearing effects and thermal effects on top of each other. That's what we would like to achieve. I don't think the world knows how to do that, at least not. We know how to do it in principle. I don't think we know how to do it routinely in a rock that we haven't seen before.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Is it asked to the, some deep drilling project?
No.
It's a subject that changed to the EGS.
Yeah, it's okay, but it's deep drilling is fine. Yeah, fine, it's fine.
Yeah, essentially, with the deep drilling is a good idea for the getting the higher temperature and also, but there is something to overcome. One of the problems is deeper field is less permeable. That's what Kasumi pointed out. And another problem, we think, is the geochemical problem caused by some sulfur or chloride. That means acidification and also some influence by the sulfur. So, and also some silica problem or scale problem. How to overcome such kind of the geochemical problem? For some, for example, Iceland, they have some idea for the overcome some geochemical problem.
Mr. Bjarni, for geochemical aspect.
Yeah, the deep drilling is a one big challenge. I hate the word problems. Challenge is a better one, or task to solve. there are two main things. One is the drilling operation itself, drilling a well down to 5 kilometers, casing it down to 4 kilometers, cementing to the surface at these very high temperatures, and all that. That is and the thermal stresses on the casings, etc. It's a number of issues, which is quite exciting. Then the second thing is Mother Nature herself, the reservoir. In a depth between 4 kilometers and 5 kilometers in Iceland, we still have seismicity, which means that the rock is brittle, in spite of the high temperatures. And brittle rock may have then sufficient permeability, but we don't know. We've never been there yet. So permeability and water and so forth, that's a prerequisite. Then the chemistry is a challenge again. And this one well we have drilled, the shallow deep well, has caused problems, different chemistry than we have in the traditional wells and so forth. So there's a range of things that we have to find a solution to, but we can only do it by doing it. It cannot done in the laboratory, it cannot done at the blackboard, or we have to have the guts to drill the wells, find money and drill the wells and do it the best way we can and learn from the outcome.
If I can add a comment about the geochemistry or the chemical aggressivity of the fluid, with our standard superheated dry steam well, we are taking steam from 3 or 4 kilometers or even deeper. We do have a lot of problem from mainly from corrosion. Several diameters has acid level, which is rather aggressive, and we are coping. We are coping with this problem with steam treatment, just installing on the drilling on the surface on the production pad a chemical treatment, just injecting something in the steam to reduce the acid level at well level if the problem could arise in the well casing or on at the entrance of the power plant in order to protect the turbine. It has a problem in terms of cost for maintenance of the equipment and for losing some of the enthalpy of the fluid because the steam is losing some degree of superheated. But we are basically installing in several, the number is 32 or 36 plant for steam treatment in our standard production well. For the supercritical well, we are facing a situation which is unknown. It is highly probable that will be a strong, very high level of acidity. And we are trying to solve the problem with a double approach. The first is selection of the casing casing and cement that will be able to support a certain level of acid attack. And second will be a fluid treatment before the heat exchanger that we are planning to install on the surface if the system will be suitable for the second phase will be the pilot plant.
You're using some high quality material prevent the acidic.
Exactly.
Treatment. I see.
And just for give you an information, the high quality material costs basically 10 times the standard.
Yes,
in
yes.
terms of cement and casing, they are the most important cost item of the well. The budget value is basically 10 times of the standard cement and casing in the standard well. I mean, 10 times more.
Okay.
Yeah, such kind of chemistry problem is common, not only for EGS, but it's or deeper wells, but it's common for the conventional systems. So let's move forward to our discussion for the technology for the conventional hydrothermal systems. We have to, geothermal is cost effective, but still we have some very high initial cost. with some development cost, development risk, because we don't know exactly where is the resources. And also we have some sustainability problems. So thinking about these initial cost exploration and sustainability, what kind of things are most important new technologies for geothermal utilization? Could you give me comments one by one? Dr. Matsunaga, please.
I have no idea, but basically the technology for the drilling technology is the best basic one. So we should, you know, diminish some of the drilling cost firstly, especially in Japan. You know, the cost of the drilling is slightly higher than compared to the other countries, I think.
So drilling technology itself is more important. Okay.
At first, we need some of the many experienced.
We need some more experience. Okay. All right. Dr. Horne, please.
I would like to suggest something a little different and a little unusual, perhaps. So one of the directions we've been following for the last 50 years in geothermal and conventional systems is steam turbines or binary turbines and, you know, resource temperatures, previously 200, 250 degrees, nowadays 150, 200 degrees. You know, if we want, and we've done very well with that, but if we want geothermal everywhere, or if we want geothermal in many more places than now, we have to look at much lower temperatures. And therefore, we need to think differently in terms of conversion methodologies, or maybe even development technologies. You know, we have examples of small binary plants producing from 70 degrees centigrade or 65 degrees centigrade or 100 degrees centigrade. And as you yourself have worked here in Japan, the hot spring, the onsen owners are producing water at 100 degrees centigrade and then cooling it to 40 degrees centigrade to put into the bath. You know, that's crazy. If you have a modular unit that can take use of that 60 degree temperature drop, it provides the electricity for the spa and maybe for outside as well. And again, you've written interesting papers about that. But we are still talking about turbines. If we don't talk about turbines, if we think about thermoelectrics, direct conversion of heat to electricity, we have a lot of material science developments in the recent past where the reason we don't use thermoelectrics today is because it's too expensive. But in terms of the semiconductor industry, they're making advances in thermoelectrics that we could have direct conversion of 50 degrees, 60 degree water, and then anybody could have a geothermal well in their backyard or underneath their house when it's under construction, and we could make use of water of much lower temperature.
So we need some more collaboration with the mechanical engineers and electric engineers.
Yes, and the material scientists for thermoelectrics.
Yeah, and what about the hybrid systems like solar, geothermal? What is your outlook?
I think that's another big advantage. Ruggero Bertani showed this excellent slide, you know, during the afternoon where the air-cooled condensers have lowest efficiency. That's when the sun is shining the strongest, and it fills the gap in between the two. So in that particular case, they actually had a big bulge, which actually is coincident with the load in that part of the world because of air conditioning. But in fact, you only need a smaller amount just to fill in the gap to make a stable amount. As you may have heard in the GRC meeting last week, I learned something new that I hadn't known before. In California, they don't like base load power. They don't like base load power because it's not dispatchable. They were happy when the San Onofre nuclear plant shut down because then they were able to use hydro and gas-fired plants to actually adjust the load as they went. So for them, geothermal loads are inconvenient because they want to run 99% of the time. We think of that as an advantage, but for the dispatch, it's actually not an advantage. So to have small modular units and the combination with solar allows you more flexibility than you would have with a big geothermal plant that wants to run 24/7.
Oh, that's something very new. Do you have any comments, Ruggero, adding to this system?
Yes, it's one of my dreams, or my best dreams, not negative one. Having something which is completely different from the approach of a big plant, that's already one question that has been addressed to my talk this morning, before the break, is something which is completely interconnected with several small plants scattered all around in a smart grid approach, matching the request with the demand and also providing flexibility. With a small binary plant, you can have the maximum flexibility because you can simply tune the pumping speed of your pumping system to increase or decrease or to use electricity when you do not need the heat, for instance. So in a combined heat and power small scale district generation or house level or hotel style generation. So the idea of a different approach, but it's not only for electricity. It should be intended in terms of heat and electricity. Electricity alone is not enough. It did not work. It should be considered as a, let's say, integrated, distributed, intelligent network of heat, electricity, production, diffuse production, not concentrated production, and, of course, diffuse utilization. And also, the electrical car can play another additional role because also, for instance, you can use the battery of your car as a source of energy in case of need, not only with the fuel cell, but also with the traditional. You can just charge or uncharge the battery. So the future, at least from a town point of view, will be something related to the several intelligent appliance and producers.
So Bjarni, do you have any comments on conventional or maybe low enthalpy systems?
We have so high temperatures, so we are in a luxury luxury situation. The power we produce is electricity is 30% geothermal and 70% hydropower. So it's okay with a little bit of base load because the hydropower is very, very flexible, the most flexible power resource you can have. And actually, because we have this great flexibility, we are now contemplating to have a cable connection from Iceland to Scotland. 1,000 kilometers of a cable to sell the flexibility of the hydro into the intermittent market of windmills in Scotland.
Mm-hmm. I have some other questions to you, especially from Iceland. I heard that your company, Reykjavik Energy, is supplying just electricity and cold water also? Cold water and hot water and heat in one company. And I think that it's a great utility because in case of Japan, the utilities for electricity and gas provider are competing each other. And it's not very good system. And water supplier is another thing. So I think it's one utility is supplying all these systems is very energy efficient system, I think.
Please.
How did you realize such a company?
Well, these used to be individual companies. The water services started 1909, power production 1921, etc. These were all combined in the year 2000, and that was not a very happy or good movement. The company got sort of out of control.
Out of control.
And the finances went down the drain.
Oh.
So basically, I came in 3 years ago to help to get the company back on its financial feet again, and we have been very successful. Oh. So it's not a good example of cost-efficient way. It wasn't. It is becoming again now.
Uh-huh,
so, but we have all services combined: cold water, district heating, hot water services, sewage. And even fiber optic data communication. So we have connected every house in Reykjavik
with
an optical cable.
Government support?
No support. This is all run today now with profit.
I see.
When you talk about the high temperature resource in Iceland, I just had in mind why in Italy we had our first binary plant only this year. We made an experiment 30 years ago with a binary plant, but we had only steam at 300 degrees. So we used the steam to heat some water to test the binary plant. That's why it was really inefficient. So we said, okay, give us the steam plant. That looks better.
I think there's many binary plant projects in Italy now, right now. Please explain about that.
You are right, because there was an important change in legislation. It was in 2012, more or less, two or 3 years ago. There was a liberalization of the market from the geothermal research. So instead of having a monopoly, how it was before, every region is not national, is a regional based, has the possibility to give the exploration permit for a certain amount of the territory to anyone who make the request, who apply for the request. There is only a problem with the different companies apply for the same area, so called concurrence, so it will be solved in a sort of a round table discussion and a sort of agreement. But with this new law, 152 exploration leases has been released by Tuscany and Lazio, Campania, Sicilia, so several regions on the Tyrrhenic volcanic arc. Is our ring of fire, our small ring of fire. Mm-hmm. And many new companies, at least 12 or between 10 and 15, 12 are the most important, are making exploration, surface exploration. They start also to drill to find new resource. And basically, we are expecting to get the temperature in the order of 120, 150 degrees, so in the binary plant range. So there will be several binary plants in the future.
Oh, I see. So liberalization of electricity changes the society.
Completely.
So, okay,
completely.
That's the third topic of today. And we are already run out of time. But if you have any questions in the end, please raise your hand.
I have a question to Bjarni on Iceland. You showed that graph showing about utilization factor of power plant, which is 95% or 99%,
yeah,
something.
99.
Yeah. In Japanese geothermal fields, as Masanasan showed, that some power plants are kind of problem of, say, reducing steam production, partly due to the scaling problem and partly due to the, two-phase zone development in the reservoir. My question is, in Iceland, how do you maintain such high utilization factor? Do you have any problem? Did you have a problem, and have you solved such problem? And you have a kind of scenario when for the in the routine in controlling your geothermal field to have a kind of strategy to operate in a high efficiency for power plants, also for direct use. I want to know what you are doing such good manner.
These are two things. One is the steam flow, sufficient and continuous steam flow to the plant at all times. and that is no big problem. We have a number of wells connected, and for the Hetli Seyði power plant, the big one, we have between 40 and 50 wells altogether, and we have at all times we have sufficient steam. Then the operating time or availability, that's a pure matter of maintenance strategy, how you maintain. And we do it very, very systematically. We have cut down downtime. Just when I came in, every turbine was stopped for 3 weeks for inspection and maintenance. We have taken that down to 1 week a year. That's totally sufficient if you do it really, really sort of focused. And all the geothermal power plants in Iceland are typically now with availability of 98%. So it's a very reliable technology. The oldest plant is 40, 50 years old, and it's over 99% availability still. No problems at all.
It's amazing. So we need such technology.
Yeah, thank you.
Please just come and visit us. I'll show you.
yeah, please.
Japanese plant. Yes.
Please continue your discussion during the next coffee break. We have to finish this session. But thank you so much for your good comments and questions to make this session very fruitful. Thank you very much for everybody. Okay, just for wrapping up, in this session, we have again recognized that the geothermal energy has a significant potential as a renewable energy source. And regarding the geothermal power generation, enhanced geothermal system, EGS, would play a very important role. And aforementioned newly developing technology can contribute to resolve a common challenge at existing power plants. The EGS technology would help to maintain the already existing power plants. And here, the technological development regarding to higher efficiency and lowering the cost should be encouraged to expand the use of geothermal heat. Geothermal heat is also important. And through today's session, we were able to recognize the importance of geothermal energy. We obtained suggestions for further deployment of geothermal energy and for the potential innovation of geothermal technologies. Thank you very much. And see you at the common session. Thank you.